In honor of Black History Month, we've decided to take a look at how Hollywood highlights our history and how stories about our community impact how the rest of the world sees Black America, as well as how we see ourselves. They say hindsight is 20/20, and we know the depictions of our people on screen haven't always been accurate, fair, or complimentary. But it seems like now more than ever, we are reclaiming our narratives, and Hollywood is finally putting a premium on authenticity. At this crucial time in our nation, when racial tensions and misinformation have hit a fever pitch, it's imperative that we reflect on where we've been to help us navigate where we're going. We'll be talking to creators whose work has made an immeasurable mark on the way our history is portrayed on the big and small screen. Writers, actors, directors, and artists who have taken on the task of telling stories that illuminate our passions, our fears, our struggles, and our triumphs. This is how Hollywood highlights our history.
Stanley Earl Nelson Jr. is an American documentary filmmaker who's been highlighting our history since 1987.
He has written, directed, and produced more than 25 projects that tell the true stories of some of our most prolific figures and chronicled some of Black America's most crucial moments. With 3 Primetime Emmys under his belt, his provocative, informative films have educated the masses by painting pictures of our past and depicting some of our greatest innovators, leaders, and heroes. He has taken us on journeys from Puerto Rico to Jonestown, highlighted heroes from the Freedom Riders to the Black Panthers, and chronicled the lives of giants like Marcus Garvey and Miles Davis. He has shown us the power of the Black press, of HBCUs, and the enduring will of our people. His latest project, Crack, Cocaine, Corruption, and Conspiracy, recently debuted on Netflix and unravels the 1980s crack epidemic that defined our community and prompted the government to declare a war on drugs and on us.
When it comes to telling our true stories, no one highlights our history quite like Stanley Nelson. How do you go about deciding what subjects you're going to tackle in your films?
You know, what we could raise money for, it's partially, you know, in doing history projects, are there visuals, you know, are there witnesses? Is it a story that we can tell? And I also think that, you know, it's we want to tell, you know, big stories that impact on today.
I can't even count how many classes I've taken that uses your work as source material. What is it like to carry the weight of knowing that so many people only know what you show them?
You know, I don't feel like I'm carrying a burden. I don't feel like I'm carrying the burden of our history. You know, in some ways, I'm just telling stories, and I'm trying to tell them, you know, as accurately and as, you know, in an entertaining and exciting way. When I did the film on the Black Panthers, you know, it was really important to kind of get it right. But all in all, you know, I consider it a real honor and privilege to be able to tell these stories.
What was one of the biggest breakthroughs or the most shocking discoveries that you made while researching one of your projects?
You know, I'm not sure. I think that you know, so in every film you have, you know, a few mind-blowing moments. I think that a huge, you know, some of the films that I did early on, $2 and a Dream, the story of Madam C.J. Walker, the Black Press, Soldiers Without Swords, you know, I think that to be able to actually tell those stories, you know, and to tell those stories in an exciting way, I think that was a breakthrough, that you could tell a story, you know, that took place, you know, 80 years ago, 150 years ago, and make it exciting, you know, and that you could throw in the kitchen sink, you know. In the Madam Walker film, you know, we have, you know, a old beauty pageant from the 1920s of Black women. You know, it has nothing to do with Madam Walker, but it has everything to do with Madam Walker.
Which of your films was the most challenging?
I think, you know, some of the most challenging were the Black Press, Soldiers Without Swords, which is like a 150-year history of African-American newspapers, and then Tell Them We Are Rising, the story of HBCUs. Because, you know, there wasn't really a story. You know, we had to make up a story to show and say something about these institutions. You know, so that, you know, the murder of Emmett Till, you know, it's a very hard film, but, you know, Emmett Till, you know, gets on a train to the South. He goes down South. He whistles at this woman or not. You know, he gets murdered. You know, the guys get caught and put on trial and they get acquitted, you know, and that's, you know, that's the story. With, you know, HBCUs, it's, well, what do you cover? You know, you could, it, the story could have gone any different way. And so those are, I think, the hardest films to do. And also, you know, there was no book. There's no book of that, you know, is the book about HBCUs. There's books about, you know, sororities and fraternities. There's books about certain schools. The same with the Black press. There's no one book about the African-American newspapers that we could use as a source.
How do you capture the core of these iconic figures that you've highlighted?
The latest films that we did about individuals were Vic and Miles Davis. You know, and Vic could speak for himself. And also, you know, there were so many people that knew Vic. Miles, you know, there are so many people that knew Miles and worked with Miles and loved Miles or didn't love Miles, you know, that we were able to interview. And, you know, kind of we have an idea, but, you know, it's almost like, you know, if you write a screenplay and then you get the best actors in the world to act it out, you know, it's 100 times better than it is on the page, you know, because, you know, and so that, you know, you find gems.
So now let's talk about your latest project, Crack, Cocaine, Corruption, and Conspiracy. Recently was released on Netflix, and it is really a mind-blowing look at the crack epidemic in the 1980s. Why this film now?
I think the story is really important because it in some ways explains so much of where we are today. You know, that, you know, the over-policing, the mass incarceration, the money that poured in to police departments to fight the war on drugs that started the police, you know, with body armor and, you know, assault weapons and tanks and all of those things that we see today, you know, that during the summer after the George Floyd murder, you know, we were looking at the police department and going like, what? You know, like the local police departments, you know, looking like warriors out of Star Wars, you know. We probably first saw a lot of that, you know, during Ferguson, but, you know, how did we get to that, you know? And part of the reason is through the crack epidemic and the fact that it got so bad, you know, so quick in so many neighborhoods that even Black people, which is really startling in the film, you know, you see African Americans calling for more police, you know, which is something that we couldn't even imagine today. You know, Black people marching for, oh, we have to have more police in our community.
Why did you decide to tell the story in chapters?
Yeah, I mean, we felt that you know, we're covering, you know, in some ways a good amount of time, you know, 5, 10, 15 years in the film, and that it almost broke down into chapters, you know. It was, you know, first, you know, it's like, you know, people were sniffing cocaine at parties in the early 80s, and you know, you go to a club, and one of the bartenders was always selling coke, and you go in the bathroom, and people are all sniffing coke, and, you know, it's like, oh, well, fun, and then, you know, crack hits, and you know, we first heard, so many people first heard about it, yeah, as freebasing when Richard Pryor set himself on fire, you know, and so it kind of like was chapters. And at first, you know, young men, especially Black and Latino men, are selling crack openly in the streets. And it's almost like, as one guy says, you know, it's like a gold rush in the hood, you know, and they didn't feel like, one, there was anything wrong, but two, that really there wasn't a lot of risk of police, because police weren't stopping it, you know. And that was one chapter. But then once the police caught on and politicians caught on and the press caught on, then it was something else. And then it led to mass incarceration. And so in the film, you know, we talk to people who use crack. They talk about, you know, getting that first hit and what they felt like. They talk about the people who's selling crack, talk about, you know, well, you know, I was working at McDonald's and this was finally real money and I could make some money, you know. But the people, all the people that we talk to, the Black and brown people, end up devastated in the film.
How do you convince someone to talk about something like this, either drug dealing or drug addiction? The subjects in this particular project were talking about times that certainly weren't their finest moments, right?
That's the part about it that we forget. I mean, you know, he says, you know, it was awesome. I had shoes, I had jewelry, I had girls until it wasn't fun anymore. You know, and that's really, you know, kind of the point. But one of the things that was really helpful is Samson Styles, who was a drug dealer, now is a journalist now, and he's one of the consulting producers on the film. And he has maintained a lot of ties to the kind of drug crack world, you know, and trying to help people. You know, he hasn't been involved in drugs in a long, long time. But he helped, you know, get people, and, you know, one thing leads to another. You know, the one thing that I've learned is how to sit back, you know, and just let people talk.
You talked to me about the crack babies myth. That was such a revelation for me.
Well, I think that it was important to include because so many people like you, you know, and like me, like so many people believed it, you know, because it was pervasive. You know, we were talking about crack babies, crack babies, crack babies. In New York, 100,000 babies will be born that'll flood the school system and ruin the school system because they're going to all have to be in special education. You know, all of those crazy, crazy myths that got believed by the majority of the population, and so I think it was really enlightening, and hopefully enlightening for a lot of people to talk about that and talk about how it was not only a myth, but it was a calculated myth. You know, it was a calculated myth that demonized Black women.
Can you think of a time when Hollywood really got it wrong when it came to representing our history on screen?
The film Mississippi Burning, you know, about the FBI in Mississippi and, you know, glorifies the FBI, who were at the very least perpetrators, at the worst perpetrators, at the very least kind of just, you know, knowingly went along with it. You know, there's rumors that the FBI, you know, got information about the bombing of the four little girls before the bombing and did nothing, you know, and that the FBI would say, you know, that we're an information gathering unit. We're not a law enforcement unit, and that's what the FBI said and did.
You know, one takeaway when you watch so many of your projects is that the police have never not been corrupt when it comes to communities of color. Why do you think so many people, even now, are finding that to be such a shocking fact?
It's very hard for white folks to face racism and to face police corruption. You know, the only way that it's happening now is by, you know, people filming it on their cell phones, and they're filming it over and over and over again. You know, in so many ways, the police came out of the idea of slave catchers, you know, and that's what they were there to do. They weren't there to protect Black people. They were there to catch Black people who were trying to escape freedom and get them back to the white folks, you know, so that's continued. You know, the police are not there to help Black folks. The police are not there to treat Black folks as equals. And I think now, you know, that we're you know, as Malcolm X says, the chickens are coming home to roost, because now you can't even, you know, get the National Guard to guard the president without vetting them and making sure they're not involved in some racist conspiracy. I mean, and that's what's really, really interesting, you know, that it's so deep at the and I can't use the word infiltrated because it's not infiltrating. You know, that's what the police are, you know, and that's why, you know, it makes sense that Black people are being shot and killed, you know, and you know, constantly by the police. If you think that you know, a piece of the police in every city belongs to some overtly racist organization and believes in some overtly racist ideology, then it's not so strange, you know, then it's a lot more believable, a lot more understandable why Black people, you know, even in the midst of the George Floyd protests, when you would think that the police would back up, you know, no, they push forward and go, yeah, that's what we do, and we're gonna do it again. And that's what African Americans deal with, and that's how we see the police.
I'm Courtney.
Courtney Wills. Thanks for joining me for this episode of How Hollywood Highlights Our History.